What we are witnessing in this global moment is not unprecedented. It is European modernity coming apart, it seems. The loosely tied myths that has kept it together are unraveling, delinking. But it intends not to go easily. The reverberating effect of its fits and fissures are being articulated in its violence. The contradictions are materialized through its human vessels like a virus seeing its inevitable demise. It is in the unity of struggle that we can inoculate the praxis of liberation to ensure this time, as with times we struggled and continue to struggle collectively against imperialism and its attendant colonialisms, chattel slavery, apartheid, etc., to follow in the tradition of resistance set before us. Today we look at a component of this unity of struggle. We pay attention to Black and Palestinian intersectional experiences with the violence of the colonial. When thinking about Black and Palestinian liberatory continuities, we have plenty to explore, but a good place we can find its most articulated expression is with Brother Malcolm. As far back as the late 1950s, Malcolm had been speaking out in transnational support of Palestinian liberation. According to Michael Fishback, several factors accounted for this. As a member of the Nation of Islam, Brother Malcolm felt a natural inclination to cultivate a kinship with other Muslims, including Arabs. Arabs had long been involved or in contact with the NOI, among them Jamil Shakur Diab, a Palestinian who immigrated to the United States in 1948 and taught Arabic at the NOI's University of Islam in Chicago. Of particular note in Malcolm's pro-Palestinian leanings were two visits he made to the Palestinians' homeland, where he first briefly toured Jordanian-controlled East Jerusalem in July 1959. During a subsequent trip to the Middle East in April and May 1964, he met in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia with Hajj Amin al-Husseini, who had been the preeminent political and religious leader of Palestine to Muslims during the period of the British Mandate. When Malcolm returned to the region a few months later for a lengthy stay in Cairo, he left the city for a two-day tour of Egyptian-controlled Gaza in September 1964. While there, Malcolm visited several Palestinian refugee camps, went to the ceasefire line with Israel, and held a press conference at the Palestinian Legislative Council building in Gaza City before carrying out his evening prayers at a mosque in the company of Gaza City's mayor. He returned to Cairo and attended a press conference given by the chair of the newly created Palestine Liberation Organization, after which he published a scathing critique of Zionism titled Zionist Logic in Cairo's English language newspaper, the Egyptian Gazette. Today, we explore Black and Palestine, its histories, challenges, and opportunities, with Ajamu, Dillahunt, and Dr. Tasneem Siddiqui. Dr. Tasneem Siddiqui is an assistant professor in the Department of History, Politics, and Social Justice at Winston-Salem State University. She has a PhD in American Studies and Ethnicity from the University of Southern California. She is currently working on her manuscript, Freedom as a Place, Black Self-Determination and Land-Based Struggles in the Low Country and Sea Islands. Her research covers the intersections of race, gender, power, spirituality, and geography, and explores how historically marginalized peoples and communities produce systems of knowledge, practice, and social movements. Dr. Siddiqui is also a valued member of the Africa World Nail Project Collective, where she is a senior researcher and associate producer. Ajamu Amiri Dillahunt is a PhD student in the Department of History at Michigan State University. He is a member of Black Workers for Justice and a board member with the Interreligious Foundation of Community Organizations. He is also a former intern with the SNCC Digital Gateway Project at Duke University. In May of 2019, Ajamu graduated from North Carolina Central University, double majoring in history and political science. Ajamu also participated in the historic Demilitarized Durham to Palestine Coalition. Our show was produced today in solidarity with the Native, Indigenous, African, and Afro-descendant communities at Standing Rock, Venezuela, Corporation Jackson in Jackson, Mississippi, Brazil, the Avalon Village in Detroit, Colombia, Kenya, Palestine, South Africa, Ghana, and Haiti, and other places who are fighting for the protection of our land, for the benefit of all people. Listen intently, think deeply, act accordingly. Thank you guys for taking the time to join us today to talk about a very important topic that is in the news right now, but also has a longer genealogy, a longer historical genealogy than I think most people give credit to. But also there's a lot of misunderstanding, but a lot of confusion, a lot of things that I think that both of you will be able to provide our listeners
not only to think about, but also to contextualize one's particular place in this moment, because this moment that we're dealing with, particularly when we're talking about the atrocities and the violence that is happening in Palestine as we sit right now and how they relate to the Black historical experience, this is a moment of opportunity. This is a moment within which it's a product of multiple moments, right? And so just to kick off this conversation that we wanna have today is that, you know, I wanna start with Ajamu. What are some of your thoughts of what's going on right now? You could, you know, what's happening in the context of the Palestine and of the atrocities and the violence that has been inflicted consistently and continually on people, but it have exacerbated itself in this particular moment. What are some of your initial thoughts as we begin to unwrap, unfold in this conversation?
Yeah, my initial thoughts are, you know, thanks for having me on the show first and foremost, but my initial thoughts is that is, you know, settler colonialism and Zionism and ethnic cleansing at play. And, you know, it comes as no surprise, it's inhumane. But in addition to the atrocities taking place and people being pushed off of their land, being killed by Israeli forces, people are fighting back. And, you know, they're not, you know, acquiescing and they're struggling in ways that they struggled since the occupation began. So it's an exciting time. And today in Raleigh, there's a Palestine solidarity rally taking place. And I have the opportunity to speak. And, you know, what I want to, you know, remind people is that this is a new era of struggle. This is a new moment of opportunity. And I remember being in Palestine and one of the co-founders of the BDS movement say, you know, the movement in the U.S. has a unique role in this struggle. Although, comrades in the U.S. may not be, you know, in Palestine, given the U.S. Supports the state of Israel and gives $3.8 billion a year, we do have an important role. So my initial thoughts, I'm just thinking about how do we really stand in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in Palestine and, you know, bring the empire down to its knees.
Dr. Siddiqui.
Thank you so much for having me. So just a kind of few reflections. This is a really important conversation that we're having right now. Like what we're witnessing, what is happening in occupied Palestine is really a reflection of the barbarism of Western civilization. We see the increased, and when we say increased, it's like, that's hard to say increased because, you know, we're also celebrating the Nebka, which is, you know, the dispossession and displacement in 1948 of indigenous Palestinians from their land, from being expelled from their homes, right? And so when we talk about the right of return for Palestinian people, this is the moment that marks that. So we see, and the Nebka literally means like disaster, catastrophe, where you saw 400 to 600 Palestinian villages that were destroyed. And so, you know, what we see right now, especially that sort of catalyzed this moment with the expulsion of Palestinian residents in the neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah, what is part of East Jerusalem, which also plays off of this sort of, you know, Donald Trump claiming Jerusalem as a capital of Israel too. So we're seeing the aggressive and violent dispossession of Palestinians from their homes, going through one by one, like house by house. And I'm also thinking about Israel as you know, an illegitimate nation state, as all nation states are illegitimate. But, you know, it is really, you know, this strategic base, this colonial imperial outpost from which the West, so we're talking about Europe and America, can really wage its neo-imperial and neo-colonial wars against Africa, Asia, and the Middle East. So, you know, there is a lot, and we can talk about this as the conversation goes on, really, to think about, you know, this moment in 1948, as you're starting to see the partition, right, of indigenous lands of Africans, of Asians, of the Middle East as well. And what this moment actually holds for us too is also this kind of continued resurgence that we saw in 2014 of these relationships of the anti-colonial, anti-imperial, decolonizing relationships between African people of African descent with Palestinian liberation struggles, with the liberation struggles in Latin America, with the liberation struggles that are happening in East Asia and South Asia as well. So, you know, this is a moment, which I hope we don't take this moment for granted and don't miss this opportunity to really start to kind of further catalyze our struggles against imperialism, neocolonialism, right? Against increased and permanent warfare as well. So, I mean, I'll stop there so we can kind of move through the conversation.
No, and this is what this is, right? It's a conversation too. And I would just want to make sure that I invite Ajamu to respond and, you know, to really have this conversation. But I really want to pull on this conceptual idea here, this notion of the colonial, this notion of the decolonial, but also in juxtaposition to the idea of a post-colonial. I think that this concept needs to be decolonized. Decolonization needs to be decolonized because, and it also relates to what you're saying, Dr. Siddiqui, this notion of a moment, this notion of a cyclical process of time that is repeating itself based upon the unanswered questions, but also a lot of the, failures, but also promises of what was being done before, which goes into my next question to kind of throw out to you guys. Can we talk a little bit about this concept, or can you respond to what I said in the context of Dr. Siddiqui just kind of eloquently, you know, really juxtapose or situated what's happening right now in this conceptual frame, this theoretical frame of decolonial, but I also want to kind of push on this notion of the post-colonial, and which also directly relates to the fallacy of a post-racial, right? So, Ajamu, can you respond to that particular statement in any way?
Yeah. So, in terms of the decolonial, the post-colonial, I mean, the occupation of Palestine, like Dr. Siddiqui mentioned, is consistent with the colonial agenda that, was taking place on the continent of Africa. Oftentimes, when I talk about Palestine or trying to introduce it, I tell people, if about colonialism in Africa, settler colonialism in Africa, the Berlin Conference, then you have some sort of understanding about what's taking place in Palestine. And so, I think people think because, the 20th century, independence movements took place across the world, and this idea of post-colonial, but in actuality, colonialism still remained, but, of course, it took a new form. But what's taking place in Palestine, what I think, it's a consistent old-fashioned, 20th century, prior type of colonialism that, we really must take action on. And I think we're in a unique position, having engaged in years of struggle, whether it be, independent movement in Africa, Latin America, on how people struggle, demands, tactics adopted and vision, for transformation, what was able to happen, what wasn't able to happen. And so I think we really must reflect on that and see, how to really, tackle, the Zionist forces and colonial forces as best as possible.
And that becomes important because Dr. Siddiqui, I obviously want you to respond to this, but I also want us to look at this in the context of the notion of solidarity as we kind of unwrap and unpack the history of Black solidarity or involvement with Palestine. Because again, the solidarity, but also the relationship between what's happening in Palestine, but also other ethnically and historically marginalized people directly relates to the conditions within which Africana people find themselves based on this notion of colonial, right? Based on this notion of fighting a colonial and a settler colonial force. But in particular here in the United States, a lot of folk do not situate or do not find solidarity, particularly people of African descent, because the conceptualization of the issues in the United States for people of African descent is not looked at as mostly as a colonial problem, right? But most people, particularly those of critical, radical thinking folk, understand the conditions within which people here in the United States, particularly Africana people of African descent in the United States, is an internal colonial problem. Can you respond to that particular notion of that solidarity and how a segment of people of African descent here find that radical connections that is also a historical genealogy of which we're going to unpack in a few seconds here?
Sure. So I just wanted to actually also to remind folks, you know, like when we talk about colonialism, what is colonialism? And I'm like, and I'm thinking about and drawing from V.Y. Madimbe's invention of Africa. And so he really lays out like these complementary theses and actions that emerge when we think about colonialism, the domination of physical space, right? The reformation or colonization, right? Of what he calls native minds, the integration of local economic histories into the Western perspective, right? The elimination or reorganization of ancient modes of social organization. And also thinking about the ways in which, you know, we have had Black radical intellectuals, people like Harold Cruz, people like Jack O'Dell, people like Stokely Carmichael of, Kwame Ture, who have articulated the situation. And then I'm also thinking about Robert Allen's work, Black Awakening in Capitalist America, who have articulated the situation of Black people in the United States as a colonial situation. So Harold Cruz, you know, he's writing, you know, from the beginning of the of Black folks' experience in the Americas, we have existed as a colonial being, right? Our enslavement, our ancestors' enslavement had coincided with the colonial expansion of European powers. And it was nothing less than a condition of domestic colonialism here. So like as the United States is establishing colonial empires in Africa, in which, you know, Dr. Pope, you have written extensively about this too, in terms of, you know, you have American architects of the Berlin Conference. So as they are, you know, European powers are reorganizing their relationships in the African continent, what is happening in the United States? You have, you know, people of African descent that are fighting Jim Crow, you know, which we should rightly call as the modalities of Black genocide in the United States. You have America expanding its imperial project in the Caribbean, so in Haiti, in Cuba, in the Philippines as well, in Guam. Right. And so those policies and practices that are getting worked out on Africans that are enslaved and then fighting that enslavement in the United States are also then being exported into, you know, these new imperial settler colonies in the Caribbean, in the continent as well, too. So it's like it's important for us to think about, you know, the ways in which those practices and policies are linked and then how our responses are organizing. Right? Our analysis is articulating this relationship. I think there was a second part of your question and I got so caught up. I wanted to make sure that I attend to that second. What was the second part of the question, if you can remind me?
Oh, I forgot myself, but Ajamu, did you want to chime in here? Because I mean, you know, laying out this continuity becomes important before we really start to unpack the history of Black relationship with Palestine. And we're going to go through the different particular components and points of continuity, because that's very, very important, really, for our listeners, because there are some people who think, well, hey, you know, there are a segment of population, not us and not the folk that we deal with, which is a smaller population. But there are some people to think about, well, hey, that's something that's happening over there. That's something that's happening to the Palestinians. There's also people who talk about there's no relationship. These notions of nationalism, these notions of Zionism, you know, are very, very important to unpack in this particular conversation, Ajamu. So could you respond to Dr. Siddiqui or add to or take the conversation in any direction? Because any direction we go in this conversation, we're going to end up back to the continuities, right? So go ahead.
Yeah, so I guess the around Zionism, I think it's important, and you know, for a more thorough understanding, I think, you know, Kwame Ture's talk is on YouTube.
That great man, V.I. Lenin, at the turn of the century, wrote a book entitled Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism.
Is it Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism?
Yes. If one would read this little pamphlet, one would see here that Mr. Lenin had precisely pointed out that all of the world had already been conquered and divided by colonial powers. There was no else in the world left to be conquered or divided by colonial powers. This is the time when Zionism comes to rise. Zionism comes to look for a state when everywhere else in the world is already dominated. Thus, in order for Mr. Herzl to get a country for Zionists, what he did was to attach himself to imperialism. British imperialism in this case, quite specifically. Of course, as an African who suffered under the heels of British imperialism, I can have no love for it, and certainly I cannot love anyone who attaches themselves to it and attaches themselves to it for the foundation of a state and then call this a liberation movement. Liberation movements fight against imperialism, not with it. Clearly here. Yes. The legal foundation of the state of Israel is what is known as the Balfour Declaration. This declaration was issued in 1917. A man in the government of Britain named Balfour wrote a paper and promised the Jews a national home. The national home he promised them was an area which Britain was colonizing, Palestine. Palestine didn't belong to the British, just like Ireland doesn't belong to the British, even though they have troops there. But here, these British imperialists signed a note and gave it to the Jews, and they accepted it. Where is the morality for this? If you say that Israel belongs to you, then you don't go to a thief to get Israel. You go and take it. Once you go to an immoral being such as British imperialism, and this is the basis for you getting the land, then clearly here those who are truly liberation fighters must question this. The basis, we say, is the Balfour Declaration, and Zionists know it. The Zionism is certainly not a liberation movement because it never fought against any imperialism. As a matter of fact, today, Zionism is the baby, child, and infant protector of imperialism in the Middle East. It carries out the interests of American imperialism. As a matter of fact, Zionism and American imperialism is like this. If our tax dollars would stop giving money to Israel, the state would sink tomorrow. And certainly no one can deny that American imperialism is the leading imperialist nation in the world. So we cannot see how a liberation movement is so tied, string and ham to American imperialism. They work hand in hand with American imperialism. Thus, they can hardly be a liberation movement. In addition to this, Zionism has nothing to do with anything religion, nothing. All religions are concerned with human beings after they die. That's what religions are for. Islam will tell you what happens to you when you die. As a matter of fact, this which forces you to live a good life so that after death you'll be able to enjoy the rewards of heaven. The same is true for Judaism. But Zionism says nothing about the individual after they're dead. They don't give a damn about you. Thus, Zionism has nothing to do with religion at all. And one should not make the confusion here. The Palestinian state belongs to the Palestinian people. This is a fact.
On a basic level, Zionism, you know, the founders of it, the quote-unquote conceptualizers of it, said it's a project built on expansion and, you know, the acquisition of land. And so Zionism openly, since its founding, was built on this project of you know, imperialism and exploitation. And so there's been a strong movement amongst, you know, people, whether it be Jewish Voice for Peace or whether it be Palestinian Youth Movement, the campaign, U.S. campaign for Palestinian rights, to distinguish, you know, Zionism from Judaism. And I think, you know, Kwame does that in that talk too. But those are two different elements. You know, Zionism is at its core, you know, a colonial project, where Judaism is, you know, is a faith. And, you know, even at the state of Israel, it's widely known at its founding in 1948, a lot of, you know, Jewish people didn't identify with it, kind of separated themselves from Zionism as a form of moving forward. And so, yeah, I think, you know, that understanding of and difference between Zionism and Judaism is foundational. And when you make that point early on to people, especially for those who may not be conscious or, you know, are you know, being introduced into the struggle, that really, I think, sets the tone early on. And also with this, in terms of, you know, you mentioned people say that we're not connected or, you know, it's happening over there, so it doesn't impact us. You know, in addition to the $3.8 billion that the U.S., you know, gives to the state of Israel, which is our tax dollars, there's also another pot of money from other U.S. agencies where it's like $2 to $3 billion, where it's military equipment, war-grade equipment, and things of that nature. But something that I think we'll get to later as we talk about the continuities in Black and Palestinian solidarity is police exchanges, is the police exchanges piece, which has presented a very important organizing tool. But the forces that have long brutalized and terrorized, you know, people of African descent in the U.S., indigenous people, and, you know, other oppressed people, are training and sharing tactics with those forces who are occupying, you know, Palestinian land, who are brutalizing and terrorizing, murdering, you know, Palestinian people. And so if that's not a connection, if that's not clear as day, then, you know, I'm not sure sure what is. And, you know, it's clear that people who avoid that, who ignore that, are intentionally doing it. The connections, the interconnectedness is there.
I wanted to just to kind of jump in though too, when we're talking about, you know, Zionism and you know, Stokely Carmichael, Kwame Ture, really articulates what Zionism is, but just to think about, you know, sort of the histories of Zionism, because, you know, Zionism is a reactionary nationalist response to these programs and massacres and hatred by European governments and European people. And it really comes out of this imperialist, old imperialist Europe. And it's a construct of secular European Jews. So the Zionist Congress, which is established in 1897 by Theodore Herzl, right? And then the idea was that, you know, to have the creation of a secular Jewish state in Palestine, right? Because they're, and we'll talk about these sort of like spurious claims that really, you know, historically don't actually bear out to the occupation and the claiming of Palestine as a Jewish homeland, but to go back to really the Balfour Declaration, right? And so the Balfour Declaration is this declaration that was really created to ensure British interests. But it's the first time that you see a European power that's officially backing the Zionist goal of making Palestine a homeland for the Jews. But what we see is in terms of like the Balfour Declaration, it comes out of a British imperialist policy because of, you know, and it comes out of the context of World War I, which is an imperialist war, right? Which you have the central powers that are trying to access more colonies, right? So you have Germany, committing, you know, massacres in Southern Africa, in Namibia. And so, you know, what the Balfour Declaration actually comes out of, it's this attempt by England to make sure, or by Britain to make sure that Russia itself, right, doesn't actually withdraw from this war against the central power. So like the Ottoman Empire, Austria-Hungary, Germany. So it's making all of these sort of like secret agreements and deals and policies, not only with, you know, the Zionist Congress, or particularly, what's his name? Heinz Weizmann and the International sort of Zionist Committee, but also making, you know, these sort of deals with, you have Sheikh Hussein of the Hashemites, who, you know, and his son Sheikh Faisal, who are trying to drum up, you know, separation from the Ottoman Empire, trying to drum up Arab nationalism to get them to fight against the Ottomans, to sort of destabilize the hold that the Ottoman Empire has on these areas that Britain and France are trying to get access to as well. So the context of Israel even becoming an actual, having some sort of materiality, comes out of these wars of imperialism, comes out of these imperial treaties and pacts that are made by France and England, right? And to a certain extent, you know, America. So I just wanted to sort of kind of put that into a context when we're thinking about the Balfour Declaration, which then really becomes sort of this claim, this even though it's not a treaty or an argument, I'm sorry, or agreement, but it really becomes this declaration of support that the Zionist Commission really takes after World War I and starts to establish, because it's before 1948 that you start to see the establishment of settlements in Palestinian areas, and when you start to see them raising money, right, and buying or taking land, Palestinian land, right, and you also start to see these real violence against Palestinian communities in an area where you had, you know, you had indigenous Palestinian Jews that were living there, you had indigenous Palestinian Christians that were living there, right, you had a more sort of multi-ethnic, multi-religious, multi-racial society that was existing prior to this British mandate that gets that really functions as the what initiates the establishment of the state in 1948.
Ajamu, Dr. Siddiqui has really laid out this historical context in the creation of the Jewish state and the creation, but also there's some points of continuity I want to highlight for our listeners that we will be getting into. So there's one particular point of continuity, the exploitation of differences is what I heard, particularly in what Dr. Siddiqui is saying, and also my own understanding of this particular history. But also clearly there's a land issue here, which is something that is consistently in the context of Black freedom movement as being an essential and fundamental component of Black liberation, right? Did you want to respond to anything before we kind of move into the explication or the unpacking of the Black historical experience or Black solidarity with Palestine?
Doc laid it out very well, thoroughly. So I don't think I have anything to add. Spot on. I took notes, you know.
Right. Right. You and me both. Right. So I also want to point out too is that when we're talking about the formation of this state, right? You know, this is 1948, correct? Also in 1948, we have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. At the same time that this dispossession is happening, right, which goes into, and you know, I'm not going to throw my research, but actually I am. I'm going to talk about, you know, the contradictions of a universal declaration of human rights or universality of human rights coming from a specific historical and philosophical experiences that is contradictory. Because at the same time that you have the dispossession of peoples, you have a world that is still colonized at this particular point. Then you have this Universal Declaration of Human Rights that is put out. At the same time, you have the formation of an illegitimate state, right? Which is also the same illegitimacy of the formation of the nation states on the continent of Africa as well. So having this particular historical foundations, and Dr. Siddiqui really laid out, you know, the historical foundations on the creation of this particular state, where it comes from and those types of things. Let's go ahead and start to unpack the histories of Black involvement, of Black solidarity and Black continuities with Palestine itself. So you can go ahead, Ajamu, and then Dr. Siddiqui will jump in right behind you.
You know, the relationship, you know, Black and Palestinian solidarity is of course, you know, with Malcolm, you know, and you know, when in 54, and he lays out, I mean, I guess one of his many critiques of the state of Israel is on, you know, Zionism. He criticizes Zionism. Of course, he travels there, but also within this context of Black and Palestinian solidarity, I think it is important to acknowledge or to have, you know, some sort of discussion about there's an element within, you know, the Black experience that supported the state of Israel. And I think, you know, somebody who we reference on the left a lot, and, you know, it pains me to say this, but, you know, A. Philip Randolph, you know, was very, very weak on the question of Palestine and supported Israel. And from, you know, Finchback's work, you know, Black Power in Palestine, he talks about some of the essays that, you know, Randolph wrote and, you know, all these different elements. So that's kind of some of the troubling, you know, troubling aspects of it that exists. But even though there's that opposition or that support for the state of Israel, I think the opposition to it within, you know, the Black tradition is still outweighs, you know, that minor, you know, support or engagement with it. So you have Malcolm, and then of course, you know, you have the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee who, you know, in 66 took a bold anti-war position and opposed the war in Vietnam. And then in 67, you know, followed up with a statement, you know, in support of Palestine. And then, you know, you had, you know, in the 70s, you know, the Black Panther Party. But another, in addition to that kind of general history of, you know, the common understanding of these major groups, you know, well into the 80s, in the 90s, the early 2000s, there was still a strong relationship between the Black freedom struggle and the Palestinian, you know, liberation struggles. And so there wasn't any gaps. And, you know, oftentimes we jump to, you know, 2014 from, you know, we go from the Panthers and bam, 2014, but it's like, hold on, in the 80s, Jackson, you know, running a presidential campaign, talking about, you know, independent Palestinian state, you know, showing his, you know, solidarity with Palestine, having, I don't know, probably one of the best, you know, kind of, I guess, policy, Middle East, you know, policies than any other, you know, candidate that was running at that time. And so you had a pretty exciting type of momentum in the 80s. And then, of course, working class perspectives, you know, you had organizations who were organizing International Working Women's Day events and always had Palestinian women, women from South Africa, you know, Black women who were engaged in working class struggles within the United States, workplace struggles in the South. So, you know, this solidarity, I think, is more widespread than just the main groups, you know, that some mentioned. And then even, you know, North Carolina Central University, you know, people like to claim A&T, you know, started the sit-in movement, you know, February, you know, all that stuff. But, you know, it's documented that 1957 students from North Carolina Central, you know, University sat in at the Royal Ice Cream Parlor, but were unsuccessful. And they were led by a brother named Reverend Douglas Moore. And, you know, you all may be familiar with him, you know, the Black Political Convention in 72. You know, he was firm in support of Palestine, uncompromising, said that this, you know, this has to be a part of it. And so you had this element engaged in the sit-in movement, challenging segregation. And then, you know, by you know, 72, you know, unapologetic about, you know, his support and uncompromising support for Palestinian freedom. And so this history is beautiful. And Finchback's work, Black Power in Palestine, I think is a good introduction to early years and some of, you know, the writings, the back and forth, even within SNCC, how they reached, you know, that position, some of the disagreements, how, you know, they may have lost funding, all those different elements are there. But, you know, the story is still being told and is still, you know, continuing today.
And I just wanted to kind of like add and maybe like fill in some stuff that, you know, Ajamu like beautifully laid out as well. So when we think about, you know, this long, and it's a long history of Africana and Palestinian solidarity. And I would even go back to, you know, the 12th century, right? So you have a large presence of an Afro-Palestinian population that lives in, you know, they even live in the African quarter in Jerusalem as well, which, you know, doesn't, and I would argue that this is the Black geographies, you know, in Jerusalem, that, you know, Afro-Palestinians themselves call that the African quarter. Everybody else doesn't call that the African quarter. But, you know, and so they were keepers of the Dome of the Rock, of Masjid al-Aqsa. And a lot of these Africans or peoples of African descent understand their history as related to Salahuddin in the 12th century. So those who were fighting these Europe's initiatory sort of imperial and colonizing attempts through the Crusades, right? And so, and this is something that Cedric Robinson reminds us when he's talking about the transmutation of Africa, that the reintroduction, so to speak, of Europe to peoples of Africa and African descent is through the Crusades, is through this real contact with this multiracial, multi-ethnic, right, multi-religious Muslim empire, who in these armies that these crusaders are meeting with are Africans, are African warriors, generals. And so this image or this relationship between Africans and Palestinians, or Africans in the Middle East, right, really haunts the political imagination and the imagination of white supremacy till this day, right? I mean, like, these are the tropes that really get pulled on when we talk about, you know, we joke and talk about how we, you know, there's 14th century thinking. I'm like, we're talking about thinking that steeps back to the Middle Ages, right? So that is always animating the real anxieties of a white supremacist logic. So I wanted to go back to that because that's important. And that's also the ways in which these Afro-Palestinians really understand their relationship to Jerusalem, understand their relationship to indigeneity in Philistine. But to kind of fast forward and this history that Ajamu lays out, and when we think about going back to Malcolm X, who was a staunch opponent of Zionism, who wrote, as you know, you had on the show, Brother Obi Igbuna Jr., who reminds us that Malcolm was writing about the Palestinian question as he was in the NOI for Muhammad Speaks, right? And then he, you know, writes The Zionist Logic, which is an article that was published in the Egyptian Gazette in 1964. And he writes about the parallels between the subjugation of Palestinians and Africans. He points out the strategic value of Israel to the world imperialism. And he says, you know, like, the ever scheming European imperialists placed Israel where she could geographically divide the Arab world and infiltrate and sow the seeds of dissension among African leaders, and also divide the Africans against the Asian. And, you know, in 1964, Malcolm becomes one of the first African-American leaders or people of African descent, or I was going to say African-American leaders, that actually meets with the newly formed Palestinian Liberation Organization. And so when Ajamu is talking about, you know, this relationship in 1967 with SNCC, and how they're coming out with this statement during the Six-Day War, you know, and it's really aggression on the side of Israel. And so they're pulling, they write this statement. Ethel Miner, who was a journalist who was very involved with organizing in Latin America, she was a member of the NOI. She becomes a secretary for the Organization of African American Unity with Malcolm X. She works with Malcolm X. She works with Kwame Ture. And SNCC publishes the Third World Roundup, The Palestinian Problem to Test Your Knowledge, which then describes Israel as a colonial state that's being backed by US imperialism. And Palestinians being victims of the subjugation. And you can also see that they're already in relationship because this Third World Roundup is also pulled almost verbatim from this 1966 pamphlet that comes out of the Palestinian Research Center. Do You Know 20 Basic Facts About the Palestinian Problem, that was founded in 1965 and really like the research and media wing of the PLO. And this move and this push comes from 2 years of organizing and studying, right, that SNCC has internally. And so one of the strongest amongst the many different amazing radical organizing that SNCC does, one of its really strong important contributions to Black liberation movements was this area of education, was this rising of political consciousness and political awareness. And so, you know, you see these urban uprisings and urban rebellions that are happening in 1967. And that also gives rise for this, and some people call it a turn. I don't think it's a turn. I think it's a natural evolution of SNCC, but them coming out really as this revolutionary internationalist organization. And so then similarly, you also see with the Black Panther Party in 1960, you know, in its founding in 1966, as it goes through this evolution from being this local organization that's fighting police brutality and white supremacy in the police to addressing the issues of Black folks globally. And something that, you know, Daruba bin Wahad, who was a member of the Black Panther Party, one of our political prisoners, was part of the Black Liberation Army. He really maps out this relationship as he was involved, right? So the Black Panther Party then evolves as this revolutionary pan-Africanist organization. And during that period, they're establishing concrete relationships with revolutionary movements around the world, especially liberation movements in Africa. And so they're meeting with, you know, revolutionary leaders, not only in Cuba, these delegates, these delegations that are happening in Cuba amongst Panthers that were exiled because of COINTELPRO, so people like Eldridge Cleaver, but also, you know, they're developing and establishing relationships when they're in Algiers, right? And so then they're in Algiers and they set up a Black Panther consulate in Algiers. And so they're in conversation, and this, you know, Algiers really becomes like this hotbed of liberation struggles. And so they're in conversation not only with the Popular Front of the Liberation of Palestine, so the PFLP, but also the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization, then the NLF, the National Liberation Front of Vietnam, ANC, PAC, PIAGC, FRELIMO, the Congolese Liberation Forces, FLN. So you see, you know, the Black Panther Party is really offering as much aid as possible to these Palestinian liberation organizations through media, through propaganda. You also then see the relationship, you know, and we don't want to be American centric, but then you see this relationship of people of African descent in Cuba. So after, in 1959, after the Cuban Revolution, you have Raul Castro and Che Guevara that go to Gaza, right, and are training, you know, Palestinians in Gaza to fight guerrilla warfare against the Israelis. And so, you know, and we can go kind of extend this more, but this is such a robust movement, and we're talking about Black and Palestinian solidarity when we actually talk about what solidarity is, right? It's not just sort of like, you know, I'm gonna make these sort of pronouncements on social media or go to a protest. It's about actually being like, I'm gonna work with you. I'm gonna travel to where you are. You're gonna travel to where I am. I'm gonna help you, you know, we're gonna support each other in the best ways we possibly can. Given understanding is like, we're not working with a lot, right? So it's through our scarcity even though there is the possibilities for abundance, but it's through our scarcity that we're actually starting to build these organizations. And in a lot of ways, we are winning. And that's the that becomes the issue. That's why you see such incredible, not only state repression, but international repression of these movements, right? Because they were successful in their organizing.
That you were spot on. I mean, that was important context, you know, dating back, you know, to, you know, Afro-Palestinians, you know, to the 21st century. That was one heck of a history. And, you know, I guess to build on that, some too.
And I just wanted to add, just as you're thinking, Ajamu, because I would be remiss, but also, you know, what comes out of this conversation, and hopefully Dr. Pope can kind of jump in this as well. In 1966, you see the creation of the Organization of Solidarity with the people of Asian, Europe, Africa, and Latin America, that, you know, it's coming out of Cuba and coming out of the Tricontinental Conference, you know, where you have people like Amilcar Cabral, who are also, you know, coming out and making the statements about solidarity with Palestinians. You also had this delegation of the Black Panther Party that goes to Beirut and is visiting Palestinian refugee camps in Beirut as well too. You have also the creation of a Palestinian Black Panther Party comprised of Palestinians that are emulating the work that the Black Panther Party was doing, not only in the United States, but then their evolution as a revolutionary Pan-Africanist internationalist organization as well. And so I think that those, you know, it's important to lay out that, you know, we're constantly have been in this internationalist framework. We've constantly been working, you know, exceeding, right, and exploding the parameters of the nation state, and also exceeding and exploding these ideas in terms of how we organize, how we think about how the political, right, and how we really think about viable alternatives to create that are not organized around colonialism or imperialism. So when we think about this politics of solidarity, you know, what, and something that Ajamu pointed out, you know, people like A. Philip Randolph or Bayard Rustin, right, who came out in support of an Israeli state, right, who are very much, you know, within that camp of a racial liberalism, right, that comes out of the context of, you know, really the violence of the Cold War and the ways in which the Cold War, anti-communism, which is anti-Black racism, really ideologically fractured and then actually physically fractured our movements. And so I think, you know, sort of one of these really important issues that when we think about is thinking about the ways in which we think about solidarity in terms of, you know, Black and Palestinian solidarity has always been about not necessarily thinking about the sort of shared past of oppression, but also thinking about this shared idea of what the type of world-making project that we're invested in, this shared idea of principles, this shared understanding of collective liberation. Like Palestinian liberation is very much connected to Black liberation, is very much connected to the liberation of Latin America, is very much connected to the liberation of Asia, is very much connected to the protection and preservation of the planet, right? So we also have to think about this level of ecological crisis that we're responding to as well, too. How we think about indigenous, right? When I talk about indigenous, I'm talking about African indigenous, First Nations indigenous, you know, indigenous to the Middle East, how we think about this indigenous knowledge systems in terms of how we relate to all life on the planet, how we represent ourselves here as, you know, stewards and custodians on the earth, how we walk lightly. And so these liberation movements are towards a more life-affirming, life-preserving principle and value and world-making system that reflects that.
Doctor, it came back to me when you were speaking, you know, as you were laying out, you know, the history about the Panthers, you know, and actually going there and, you know, SNCC, you know, all these different elements and the really unpacking the type of solidarity that took place. You know, earlier I mentioned the 1980s, but I also wanted to provide, you know, some, you know, specific examples about, you know, how the 1980s was a time period, you know, of revolutionary possibility and revolutionary struggle in general, especially on the continent of Africa. You know, our brother Thomas Sankara, he was, you know, in a lot of his speeches, he's talking about Palestine and uplifting the Palestinian struggle. And then, of course, our brother in Grenada, Maurice Bishop, and, you know, the New Jew movement, they're also talking, you know, about Palestine. And then, of course, you have the anti-apartheid movement taking place, and Palestine is being inserted within that conversation, too. And so, you know, the 80s is representing a beautiful time period. And a lot of, you know, revolutionaries, you know, in the United States during that period, you know, were studying, you know, of course, you know, Cabral, you know, and Nkrumah, but also, you know, Sankara, you know, and Bishop, too. And so, you know, that time period represented, you know, a new phase, but a continuity in terms of that engagement in Palestine being a part of, you know, a revolutionary identity, a revolutionary movement, revolutionary future. And so, yeah, oftentimes, you know, when we talk about it today, too, you know, people say we need, you know, for the Palestine solidarity movement, you know, what took place, you know, with the anti-apartheid movement, that type of momentum, energy, you know, people not being able to, you know, not being able to avoid, you know, talking about it. And it seems like that moment, you know, right now, you know, we may be in that period where people have no choice but to talk about it. You know, Representative, you know, Tlaib, Cori Bush, you know, their talks on the, you know, on the floor, you know, while some, you know, might dismiss them, they were very powerful. And showing, you know, even if, you know, these, you know, elected officials who usually stay silent, especially, you know, Black ones, but for them to, you know, take this position, you know, on the floor, you know, publicly to the world, and say, you know, we support Palestinian freedom, is important. And also, you know, Cori Bush, Representative Bush, Congresswoman Bush, in her talk, she talks about, you know, a Palestinian brother who was part of the Ferguson uprising. And how he was bringing the question of Palestine there, but also just sacrificing for the Black freedom movement there. And so in terms of this continuity, you know, you see, you know, a lot of shifts and, you know, new potential for different types of solidarity. And we're at that moment right here, right now, where, you know, we can have a new type of solidarity, especially on the question of Black and Palestinian solidarity. And then even on the question of, you know, Afro-Palestinians, I know Mark Lamont Hill has been doing some work, you know, with Afro-Palestinians, and, you know, has a documentary coming out. And then I just saw on Twitter that a brother who's a co-founder of the Dream Defenders, he's Palestinian. He was responsible and played a major role in Dream Defenders going to Palestine in 2014. They're coming out with a documentary, you know, 10 days, you know, I think in the Holy Land. So, you know, these documentaries are coming out, connections are being made. And, you know, hopefully I want to talk about, you know, in terms of campaign struggles, you know, of trying to, you know, fight, you know, the U.S. empire and, you know, the state of Israel. There's also some promising things there, building on that long, you know, tradition that goes back centuries, like Dr. Siddiqui laid out.
And I want to actually piggyback up on this particular point. I want to make this point, too, when we're talking about, you know, political officials, or there's Cori Bush and these folk. I mean, having a statement on the floor is one thing, but making sure that these statements are connected with movements on the ground is something else. So while these, you know, we want to recognize them, but we don't want to situate them in what we're talking about in the context of this longer on the ground, people to people, community to community, solidarity that stretches back. Because one of the things that I was thinking when Dr. Siddiqui was making this point, we also have to talk about, you know, the point that she made, particularly with SNCC, we talk about the turn that they make, but that's not a turn, because the radical organizations, the people that are dealing with people and understanding how the same systems of oppression of the same oppressing Palestinians are the same global systems that was brought forth by European 14th century expansionism as a product of 10th through 13th century ideological and philosophical ways of understanding the world. And Dr. Siddiqui, I want you to talk about that a little bit more, because at the crux of these particular conflicts, again, it's the exacerbation of differences as erroneously and narrowly defined, but erroneously understood based upon these religious principles, a cultural principles that was something that was antithetical to a European understanding of their relationship with each other, but also the world, because we cannot talk about any of this without talking about those relationships, but also to really talk about the long genealogy. We can talk back We could think back to the Southern Negro Youth Congress, those young people who had an internationalist view, who were dealing with folk from the Middle East, from India and other places, you know, having, you know, personal relationships with the with some of the folk who actually started, you know, that particular organization. We can't talk about, you know, the relationship of Black solidarity. And again, we're talking about a particular form of solidarity. We're not talking about, again, as you said, Dr. Siddiqui and Ajamu, this platitude of just hashtagging, you know, and you know, kind of, you know, watching a speech or giving a certain, but you got the Council on African Affairs, who had a very clear understanding of an internationalist view. It is actually ahistorical for Black folk, particularly people of African descent, whether they're in the United States or in the Caribbean or in South America, to not have an internationalist view, to not have a understanding of themselves in relation to the global context. Because again, the systems within which we are fighting, as Sylvia Winter eloquently talks about, right, this moment, this 1492 moment that really, you know, exacerbates or institutionalizes these ideological principles of superiority that Europeans had within themselves, right? This was already embryonic, and this racism was already embryonic in the way that they understood themselves in relation to the world. So as the economy is developing, as they're moving out, they're discovering themselves through other people, but then calling other people other, right? So I think that that's important to talk. Could you talk a little bit about, you know, that moment, you know, that Cedric Robinson talks about, this moment of Europe discovering itself, because this is also in, you know, when we're talking about ethnic groups within Europe or as a product of Europe, this is also related directly to them discovering themselves, but also trying to attach themselves to a whiteness.
Sure, no. I wanted to kind of like, something that Ajamu said, especially about the one of the co-founders of the Dream Defenders, because, and this was to kind of the earlier point that you had made, James, in terms of like, you know, we're thinking about, you know, the actual real relationships that people are creating on the ground, right? As opposed to thinking about, you know, these folks that are, you know, in this sort of ruling class or ruling elite, or this sort of political class. And one of the co-founders of the Dream Defenders, Ahmed Abu Znaid, you know, his father was actually a member of the PLO diplomatic corps that actually hosted at the time, Stokely Carmichael, in a solidarity delegation to the Middle East, right? And so you see like these continuities of these relationships. And once he understood that, you know, that relationship that his father had with SNCC, that his father had in terms of like these Black and Palestinian solidarity movements. So he's also then that inspired him more to draw on these historical legacies and to sort of revive or catalyze this long history of Black and Palestinian solidarity. So I just wanted to kind of like, I wanted to talk about that before we talk about this moment that you're talking about in the 10th, I believe it's the 10th and the 12th centuries too. And so part of it is too, is that, you know, once you see the real, the destruction of the Roman Empire, right? Its administrative destruction of the Roman Empire, you see, you know, what gets constituted later on, because remember, Europe is not, has to be invented, right? Europe is invented. And something that's so interesting about something that President said, you know, or these people be doing like these mad archival deep dives. They had brought up this point that something that Joe Biden said years ago is that if Israel had not been created, we would have to create it, right? And so, I mean, similarly, I think about that in terms of Europe, right? In terms of the creation of Europe, is really not a discrete entity, but is part of this sort of political imagination. And so, you know, as Europe, what now gets constituted as Europe, as it is sort of devolving into this tribal warfare, right? And has lacked really access to knowledge of the rest of the world. You see the ways in which that it becomes reintroduced to Africa is through literally these translation movements that happen Cedric Robinson says in the 12th and 13th century, where new knowledge is not actually being created, in Europe. New knowledge is not being created. They're in this process of translation. They're translating all of this old knowledge that's coming out of Greek and coming out of Rome, right, about Africa. So they're not producing new knowledge of this. And then they're also learning about, you know, these trade routes. They're learning about these resources, right? They're learning about, you know, the sort of the abundance that is to be had that comes out of these trade routes that are coming out of the Middle East. And so as it's starting to learn about, you know, Africa, the rest of the world, it's starting to create this image of itself in juxtaposition and in negation really of that, right? So it doesn't have a real clear identity of itself, but it's creating its identity in what it sees, it perceives itself not to be, right? And this really becomes sort of like the basis of European thought, really European knowledge systems. And so we see that later on with the Enlightenment period. But this period that Cedric Robinson is really talking about is this crucial moment in the 10th to the 12th to the 13th centuries, when you're starting to see, you know, Europe itself, Italy, what becomes Italy, what becomes Portugal, right? Trying to create some sort of place within these world powers, especially as it comes around knowledge, but then access to these economic, so to the wealth, really. And this is the sort of the rhetoric around the Crusades, is trying to access this abundance wealth, not only just of knowledge, but actually abundant material wealth that comes out of these Islamic states or these Islamic empires. And so you see like Arab scholars between the 7th and 10th centuries that are, you know, have, you know, had really undergone this incredible intellectual project of translating all of these Mediterranean predecessors from Greek to Latin into Arabic. But in that process of doing that, they are then also, you know, creating the conditions of possibility. I think, obviously, this is the unintended consequence, the conditions of possibility for the rise of Europe. And there's a lot of different sort of factors in that, but I'll sort of stop there and then sort of let us pick up on that conversation, if that answers your question.
No, it does, because to me, as a person who studies the idea of what it means to be human, but in particular, what it means to be human in the context of an African, centering an Africanness or an Africanness, Europe discovering itself is also at the simultaneously discovering its inhumanity, right? So, because then out of this particular milieu, this particular environment, you have these people, right, that make up Europe itself. They're also ethnic groups who are understanding themselves in relation not only to knowledge and the dearth of knowledge or the lack of knowledge, but also the systems within which they use their spiritual technologies to make them be human in a global or material world, are now in contestation with each other, right? Because again, you have African indigenous systems that are robust, complex understandings of what it means to be human. So at the same time, again, this period, again, is in translation, which is very, very important. But as they're translating, they're also inscribing their superiority on these translations.
And I just wanted to say, because I would be remiss if I did not say this, is there's also, this is coupled with, you know, because it's coupled with the Crusades. So incredible religious fanaticism, right? So this is one of the ways in which we see how, you know, race is articulated through religion, right? And also incredible carnage and violence. So what makes these Italian city-states and mercantilism possible is through this process of the Crusades. And so when you made this point about Europe discovering its inhumanity, and this is a point that Emmy Cesar makes in Discourse on Colonialism, right? It's not, Europe doesn't rise because it is intellectually superior, right? Because it's not, right? I mean, all of the knowledge systems that it comes from everybody else, right? And y'all just Christopher Columbusing it and figuring it out, you know, after we've known this for 300,000 years. But its ability and its incredible ability to wield unimaginable forms of violence. And that's really the crux of it, right? This is also what we see right now that's happening in Palestine. This real at the center is this genocidal imperative. And that's something that I think that, you know, we have to really deal with in a real way, because when we're talking about, you know, indigenous knowledge systems, African indigenous knowledge systems, our spiritual technologies, what is at the center of that is life, is the protection and preservation of life, right? What is at the center of that is balance, reciprocity, keeping things in harmony. And I'm not trying to romanticize it, that's the principle, right? And so how the principles get enacted, that's gonna change in terms of time and space, but the principle itself, right? We think about, you know, ancient Egypt where people had to recite the 42 laws of Maat every single morning. So you're constantly reminding yourself every single day what, you know, what your imperative here is as a one form of life in interdependence and in relationship with all other forms of life, with all other forces of nature, right? With the spirits that's in the, you know, in the wind, in the rocks, in the trees, in the flowers, in the birds, and in everything, right? And that's what's fundamentally, right, you see that gets really emphasized in this period that Cedric Robinson is talking about. Right, in this period of the 10th to the 12th, to the, you know, well, I would say from the 10th century to present.
Definitely present, because we're living in 14th century logics and the 21st century realities. And again, this idea of intercommunal living in the context of all life, which is very, very important. Ajamu, did you wanna add to this or?
No, I want to give praise and appreciation for this lesson, taking notes. And I'm just reminded, you know, while I always love to be around you all, because I'm being pushed, you know, I'm learning a lot, and it's just great. So I know the listeners are really enjoying this, because this is good stuff. This is good.
Well, thank you. So, because this is what we try to do. I mean, again, and we have to be clear. I think it's important how we contextualize or conceptualize our the issues and not paying attention to and studying the rhythms of history and how they relate, the continuities of history, as not only in its material manifestation, but also its non-material manifestation. What ends up happening is that we start to use different frames or the wrong frames of the tools to address these particular problems. But this is what the reason why having this conversation in particular and expressly and specifically on the relationship between the violence that is being inflicted upon the Palestinian people and its direct relationship to Jim Crow, imperialism, colonialism, near all the colonialisms, apartheid. The average person can see the clear continuities of those, whether they address them or not, or attempt to situate themselves in this longer genealogy that we're talking about. Because you, Ajamu, you made a very, very important point. You know, you said it pains you to say, "Hey, Philip Randall," it don't pain me, because we have to be clear about their inconsistencies and their contradictions, because their contradictions are usually personal, right? We talk about Max Ergen, you know, who was radical at once and then became one of the most rightest of the right, right? You know, we have this, but we also have this relationship of the personal, this individualistic. That's me. To me, I look at that as people who make those abrupt terms are really defining themselves as being individuals, because again, they don't have the structures of the intercommunalism that Dr. Siddiqui just talked about. So let's unpack the specific points of continuity of what is happening right now, but also historically. But we can use the point right now, because we clearly see there's a video that the Al Jazeera put out about this. You know, one settler is going to this to this woman's home, and he's like, you know, if I don't steal it, somebody else going to steal it. I mean, the clear violence is the same violence that has been consistent. We saw this with Black farmers in the United States. They're like, give it to me, right? We saw this with the indigenous people, our Native American brothers and sisters, the same exact type of mentality. So when we're talking about this violence, when we're talking about, you know, the carrying, we often talk about the resistance and how it continuities, but what about the violence that carries itself over and over? You know, is something that needs to be addressed as well. Can we talk a little bit more about the specific continuities that you guys see, but also maybe a few that, you know, it's not in the mainstream or not in the dominant discourse. What are some of the specific continuities? And Ajamu, you talked about the police violence. Could you talk a little bit about even the work that you did, you know, in the militarization here in the United States and the police force training? Can you start there and then we'll kind of unpack it from there, and Dr. Siddiqui can jump in after you.
Oh yeah, for sure. So in 2014, you know, after, you know, the murders of Mike Brown, the list, you know, can go on and on. You know, there had been that revive, you know, Ferguson had been that revive, Black Palestinian solidarity, more attention, was coming to it. And then there had been an effort by a number of forces to really bring out how, you know, those connections are taking place materially. And so the tear gas canisters that were being used against Palestinians were the same ones, you know, being used in Ferguson and different parts of the country for people protesting against police violence. And so that, you know, sparked a deeper investigation. And then it had been, you know, come to attention that for a long time, police in the United States had been training in Israel on, you know, counterterrorism, all kinds of stuff. I mean, the brutal nature in which we see today, they were training with each other. And of course it wasn't one-sided. These are two, oppressive institutions training with each other. And so a movement sparked to end these exchanges, but not just simply to end exchanges, but to bring attention to the occupation, what it means, to bring attention to how it overlaps with, Black people in the United States, indigenous people. In Durham, we became the first city. I shouldn't say we, because I don't live in Durham anymore. I live in Raleigh. But Durham, you know, became the first city to end these police exchanges, not just through, you know, some sort of, you know, oh, we should end these exchanges. It was real organizing. So the Black Youth Project 100 had been part of that coalition, this organization called Spirit House. And a host of other groups. I mean, UE 150 was a supporter of the campaign. And so an effort to end these exchanges brought people from different sectors of society into one type of coalition to fight these exchanges, to bring Palestine in conversation, you know, the local and international, and just see the overlap. And out of that 2018, you know, we became the first city. And the thing is, though, Durham may have happened. I think there were maybe two other places that passed resolutions to end exchanges with the police departments in the U.S. and Israeli occupying forces. But there's still a wave of departments still being trained. In some cases, there's no struggle to make the connections, or the power structure is intentionally trying to prevent people from seeing that those connections are there. A recent network just launched called the Demilitarized U.S. to Palestine, where you have these different local efforts taking place in conversation with each other, but also thinking about how to expand, you know, this type of coalition building and to really bring, you know, in terms of a tangible piece, how to really build this, you know, Black and Palestinian solidarity and, you know, just solidarity with Palestine in general. And so in Raleigh, you know, At the rally today, we're launching our coalition, Demilitarized Rally to Palestine, because it's interesting, because in 2014, you know, with Mike Brown Ferguson, that represented, you know, a new phase of, you know, Black and Palestinian solidarity. But then you have here with, you know, George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, a new form, you know, I mean, around these police. So in 2014, you had the bombing of Gaza. And then you also had, you know, Mike Brown, and you had to come together. And then in 2020, you have, you know, George Floyd. And then 2020, you have, you know, what's taking place in East Jerusalem, Gaza. And then, you know, the tear gas and, you know, violence taking place, you know, in people's, you know, place of worship in Palestine. So how it's unfolding is very, very, very interesting. But we found out that the Raleigh police chief traveled to Israel in 2017 to receive a training. And the thing about this is, docs, it was hidden. So we found this out in an Atlanta journal. So it wasn't, Raleigh didn't uplift it, or it wasn't posted on any Raleigh news services. It was through an Atlanta. I mean, it was just based on doing some research. We found it like hidden right there. And so now we're gonna launch a campaign, you know, in the capital city of North Carolina to end these exchanges. We're launching today at the rally and using this momentum to really, you know, build this thing out. But all this to say is that, there's a new wave of energy coming. There's direct ways that people can engage and struggle, and we can build this solidarity in new and profound ways. I mean, it's there, it's ripe, you know. But we have to take that action and be intentional about it, and connect it to, you know, this current wave of the struggle against police brutality. You know, whether it be abolition, defund, divest, you know, all these different elements. You know, it has to be infused in it, not something like, oh, this happens. It has to be a core part, you know, of the campaign. We have to have that organizational response. And then one other thing, when I went into Palestine in 2018, you mentioned Black farmers, it was a part of an olive harvest delegation, an environmental justice delegation. And as, you know, the Palestinian farmers were talking about the land, the importance, you know, of olive, we went to an olive harvest festival. I mean, you know, I wasn't trying to detract from the Palestinian struggle, but in my mind, I just could not stop thinking about, this just seems like, you know, Black farmers. I mean, it was so there that you couldn't avoid, you know, not thinking about it. And then another thing, which I don't want to make any overgeneralizations, but in the concept of, we went to a university, a Palestinian, you know, university, and, you know, it had me thinking about, because they offer courses for Palestinians. I mean, to receive the education, it centered, you know, resistance, social justice, art. I mean, all forms of, you know, expression in terms of resistance. And it had me thinking about, you know, historically Black colleges. While, you know, the founding of both, you know, these institutions, you know, one in Palestine and, you know, a couple in the U.S. is totally different. But and administratively, HBC is a little different. But in terms of the faculty, the students, and the tradition of struggle that exists at HBCUs, you couldn't avoid seeing some of the similarities in that front. So although there's some differences, and you know, context is important there, but you couldn't help but see that, you know, education is serving as, you know, a foundation for this resistance and Palestinian liberation theology, Black liberation theology. I mean, the origins of it are just, you know, I mean, it's Reverend Michi Rahi, you know, who's you know, a Palestinian, you know, he produces a lot of stuff on Palestinian liberation theology. And so while I was there, it was just like almost in not all aspects of society, but a good amount of society beyond the police, you see overlaps and struggle in the spirit of resistance, you know, the Palestinian people. I mean, it's above admirable. I mean, it's something that, you know, should be learned from, and, you know, not only studied, but, you know, celebrated.
And if our listeners haven't figured out by now, you know, we at the program and in our collective, as Dr. Tasneem talks about, is that we choose our guests very carefully, right? We choose our guests. We are very intentional, but we are very intentional in the context, because you're talking about continuity. Is that Ajamu is part of a, if our listeners haven't figured that out right now, he's clearly an activist, right? He's clearly, you know, as he taught, you know, he's a PhD student, you know, developing as we all did, coming from activist background. We needed to develop a more systematic way of studying our history in order to use it as a form and a platform to really refine what we're doing on the ground, or how we're connecting on the ground. So I just wanted to make that really point, you know, to our listeners, you know, as far as Ajamu is making this point. And when you're hearing him, you know, he's saying the work that he's doing in the context of this and launching these campaigns. I just want to make that particular point. And then Dr. Siddiqui, I wanted you to kind of chime in here as well.
Sure. And I wanted to also point out, you know, what, you know, so what Ajamu was talking about, this relationship between the police in the United States and then, you know, relationship between the IDF and Israeli police too. So, you know, NYPD as well has a liaison center in Israel. You know, the NYPD intelligence division oversees liaison to the Israel National Police, right? And so when we think about, and, you know, when we're bringing up this issue, particularly of the murder of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd, you know, and thinking about gentrification as this modern form of settler colonialism as well. So, you know, the police, and you have, you know, at least, and when we think about, you know, how we organize our information, how we understand knowledge, it comes out of a collective process. So I'm thinking also about this conversation, you know, with Daruba bin Wahad, who, you know, makes this point very clear. He's like, listen, you know, you have over, at the time in 2014, you had over 2,000 Americans that were in Israel, right, either fighting with the IDF or serving as liaisons to the Israeli police, right? And these are the people that are coming back, and he said this, right? This is Daruba bin Wahad, this is not me, you know, killing your grandmother in her house, right? Or killing, you know, our brothers and sisters on the street too. Like those are these are direct links, right? So you're, you know, people like neighbors and people that you work with or whatever are going to fight, you know, in Israel with the IDF killing Palestinian children, right? Killing Palestinian men, women, and children in their homes, right? And so this is an important link that we're thinking about in terms of like the, not only we like to talk about the militarization of the police, but the police have always been a military force, right? They've always been, you know, part of a militia, part of this occupying army and occupying force. The other point that I wanted to make in terms of when we think about continuity is something that Ajamu had brought up. You know, you have this push that happens in this past decade of AIPAC trying to organize on HBCU campuses, right? Advocacy for the state of Israel using Black students through the Sheldon Adelson funded Maccabi task force. You have, you know, them using Black students to spread awareness on campuses of and support for a Zionist state, right? That really flies in the face of, you know, all of the work that we're thinking about in terms of, you know, building these relationships, but not only just building these relationships between Black and Palestinian communities and all, you know, sort of our third world decolonizing movements, but understanding that our ability to live is intricately tied to Palestinians' fight for freedom as well too. So it's like a real brutality and slap in the face for us as people that work on HBCU campuses who value and care for our students' lives, that they would be, you know, they are being recruited to not only through, you know, AIPAC, but also the CIA, the State Department, that is really antithetical to life. And then as part of the apparatus that is not only killing us in the streets, but part of the apparatus that is locking us up and putting us in cages as well. The other point that I wanted to make up when we think about these continuities and this beautiful point that Ajamu brought up, especially around Palestinian farmers and Palestinian land, indigenous land, similarly, you know, I went to see these olive groves that were being demolished by the IDF, and thinking about this connection between what's happening in Sheikh Jarrah, thinking about this connection that happens in with the dispossession going back to 1948, and understanding the ways that Palestinians were pushed out of their homes, their bank accounts, their personal effects, the libraries were seized without compensation, and all of these actions were rendered legal by Israel's absentee property law that was established in 1950. The ways that Black farmers lost their land were through legal apparatuses that were established here in the United States, right? So you have, at the turn of the 20th century, Black farmers have amassed at least 14 million acres of land. By the turn of the 21st century, 90% of that land was dispossessed from, using legal mechanisms in order to do that too. So like these are, you know, thinking about, and this is, you know, again, I'm going to throw sort of like a lob to James about the work that the really critical work that he's doing in terms of thinking about, you know, the ways in which these legal frameworks, right, reproduce, you know, settler colonialism, reproduce imperialism, reproduce anti-Black racism, reproduce like these death dealing and genocidal systems as well, and the name of law and order, right? And the name of this being illegal, right? And so you see the creation of illegality through these legal mechanisms. And so the last point that I kind of want to make up, and when we think about Sheikh Jarrah, we're talking about settler colonialism, this is gentrification, right? And we see this happening throughout the African world. Right, we just had a conversation a couple of months ago too, and we, you know, one of our African World Now Project collective members, Kurt Orderson, that did this incredible film, Not in My Neighborhood, mapping modern day forms of settler colonialism in Cape Town, in New York, and Sao Paulo, Brazil, but it's not limited to those areas, right? And so we're looking at these sort of connections and continuities. The ways that Breonna Taylor is murdered is because of gentrification, right? We're here in DC, right? You're there in Raleigh, you know, and we're seeing that, you know, the ways in which gentrification or settler colonialism is happening, and it happens, you know, in a similar way in terms of what the Palestinian communities are experiencing, right? So just those are some of the continuities that I wanted to sort of draw out for us.
And I think that they're essential, and there are two points that, well, actually there are three things that I want to kind of close out, because we can have this conversation, you know, forever. And I really appreciate you guys' time. And so one of the things I wanted to kind of go back to what you both were talking about in the context of, you know, this notion of an education, or the notion of understanding how we are taught to map and put together information, because that's what I think education is supposed to be. Education is really supposed to, we're supposed to be guiding folk, or providing information and helping map it, because information unorganized, as I say this constantly, it's just information, right? We have to have a purpose and intentionality to put this information together. And which is interesting is that we cannot remit, we will be remiss to even talk about the fact that Zionism, as is being articulated, one of the purposes that the originator of the notion wanted to go back is to establish a university, right? So I think that's very, very important.
This point that you made, James, in terms of thinking about, in April 1918, when Heinz Weizmann travels to Palestine, and their intent is to lay this foundation of a Hebrew university that would be then, you know, like the intellectual hub of Zionism. I'm thinking about that, you know, the ways that we think about, and we know this, right? So we know that the university is not an uncontested space, and it's very much a corporation, right? And a very much, you know, part of that terrains of struggle, because, and this is something that, going back to Sylvia Winter and her article, No Humans Involved, which is an open letter to her colleague, she's basically talking about and indicting, it's like this knowledge system, right, of the non-human, of the wretched of the earth. She's like, that is happening. These logics are getting worked out here, right? And we're reproducing them, right? And so that's what's informing these practices that you see of, you know, the police, they're a military arm of the state. And to kind of go back to what is happening on HBCU campuses, and this is important because, you know, like PWIs, like y'all got, you know, Research One universities, that's their own struggle. We have a very particular struggle at HBCU campuses. And, you know, the AIPAC coming and trying and really not just AIPAC, but the CIA, the State Department, Homeland Security, creating pipelines for Black students to go into law enforcement agencies as well, too, creating classes, certification programs, for them to be wrapped up within and be an arm of the state, which is, like, for me, is like the deepest level of perversity you could possibly create. But then to actually have, you know, AIPAC coming to HBCU campuses, and really because, you know, we don't have one of the ways, and I was reading an article in the Times of Israel, so like they state it themselves, you know, one of the reasons why they're going to HBCU campuses is, again, to play on, which is, has to be, and maybe this is another conversation that we should have, to try to play on these continuities between this Black and Jewish, or Black and Black and Zionist connection. Right? That, you know, that is happening within a particular time and space. And a lot of that has to do with, you know, the church. A lot of times, like, we found, you know, ways to articulate our liberation through liberation theology, right? But we are articulating and expresses these stories in a very different way. And that has to be really, like, attended to. So they're playing on these sort of like older relationships that were fractured. Like, we have to be clear about that. They were fractured, particularly by young Black students, by young organizers that understood that, yeah, we might have this sort of quote unquote shared past, even though that needs to be really muddied up, right? Our visions for the future are not the same, right? Our principles are not the same. And so, you know, what you see what's happening on HBU's campuses, especially as, you know, you have, and number one, it's like a lot of times, like, you know, we're not doing the job, not us, because I'm not, but some of our colleagues are not doing the job that needs to be done in terms of actually really providing an education, right? An understanding, a critical reading of the world, right? And understanding students, their role and their place within that, where they have this sense of familiarity. They have this deeper expansive knowledge of who they are and what they need to be doing. But then AIPAC coming and trying to organize and advocating for students is primarily because there's an absence of the BDS movement as well. So a lot of the BDS movements were focusing on PWIs, but I was like, you're not creating communities with HBCUs, right? And for us that are at HBCUs, I'm just gonna put it all out there, because I'm like, I think that's something that needs to be said. We're in the trenches, right? We are overworked, underpaid, have hundreds of students that we are interacting with. Our students have very different needs than students at PWI. I'm not to say that there aren't students at PWI, they're not coming from our communities. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying is that we have very different sets of conditions that we're dealing with, right? And so it's up to the responsibility of our colleagues and our comrades that are at PWIs and making sure that this knowledge is getting to our students, that there are active BDS campaigns of boycott, divestment, and sanctions, that there is an active counter discourse that is happening, and people are not playing on these sympathies or these nostalgias of a relationship that was really fraught in to begin with. Right, and Malcolm expresses that to us, like what actually is happening on the ground. W.E.B. Du Bois expresses this in Souls of Black Folks as well too. There's not, and this sort of hegemony of Zionists in social justice movements as well. You're not the gatekeeper of social justice, right? You're not the gatekeeper of liberation or freedom.
Well, you could have fooled all of us, because you know the brilliance of a lot of us on these particular campus. I mean, they keep recycling, you know, the same folk. And this is not to say that, you know, we're trying to say that there's a struggle exceptionalism here, because that's not exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about parity. We're talking about balance. And we're talking about really mending and shoring up these continuities that a lot specifically came from HBCU campus, but literally from HBCU campuses and of people such as ourselves were produced by the community. Right. So even Black studies, Africana studies comes from the community. Right. So that those notions, as you know, we teach in Africana studies, we make these continuities clear. Right. But these are not even being transmitted, you know, and Ajamu could tell you, because we both, Dr. Siddiqui, we come from PWIs. Right. Ajamu's went from HBCU to a PWI. So we see the clarity of the disconnect, but also this notion of a Compadre class of Black so-called intellectuals, right, who are carrying on this apartheid system, of the intellectual apartheid system, you know, that is very, very important to talk about. Why? Because this is the reason why we're having this conversation, right? We're having this conversation in the context of understanding the continuities of the struggle of the Palestinian people in relation to the Black liberation movement and all of its manifestations, right? And that becomes important. And I didn't mean to cut you off, because again, you know, as you were saying, I mean, I wanted to make sure that we kind of encapsulate that, and to make sure that what we're talking about here is parity, what we're talking about here is solidarity and continuity, right? Continuity, and if you have space, and this is how do we, you know, this goes back to the undercommons, this goes back to this notion of expanding the space, and this is what we try to do with this space, is to expand it. As Ajamu would say, we're not only expanding on our campus, we're trying to build international substantive community relationships, which is something that doesn't make us extraordinary. We stand in a tradition, right? And we're very clear about that. We're building on a tradition that we're trying to also carry on. Because why? There were folk that was in your life and in my life that did that for us. So it's important for us. So meeting Ajamu, right? Clear, he's not that much longer than us, actually is. But the point being is that we want to make sure that this carries on, right? We want to make sure, because when folk who took the time to talk to us, to kind of nurture our intellectual, radical intellectual curiosities, right? We want to make sure we do that for any student or any, and we generally don't call our students, we, you know, because we don't look at them as students, we look at them as being first human beings, but people that we think with, you know, our ideas labs that we create. With that being said, I want us to touch on this notion. Again, reason why I think this is important, this is a segue into talking about Afro-Palestinians, right? Because in the midst of all of this, we talk about Palestinians or Palestine, but there's Afro-Palestinians who identify clearly as being Afro-Palestinians who are in the midst of all of this, just like Clarence Lussain and other folk who talks about Hitler's Black victims, right? So I think it's important to really put this into the center of the conversation. Again, not for struggle exceptionalism, but for context, to understanding. If you don't understand the points of continuity, we want to give you so much that you have no excuse but to latch on to a point of continuity, right? So we want to talk about that a little bit. Dr. Siddiqui, you want to talk about, and you mentioned it earlier, you know, Afro-Palestinians, but you want to talk about that in the context of our conversation.
You know, so I had mentioned this earlier too, you know, you have a large Afro-Palestinian community. You know, when we think about, you know, even actually, so when I went to Palestine, it was during the Second Intifada, which was happens in 2002. And so I was also thinking about, you know, like the first martyr in the Second Intifada was Afro-Palestinian child, right? From that was from the African quarter. And so you have contemporary communities of people of African descent that, you know, while you have some communities that have, you know, that trace their ancestry and their origin with Salahuddin in the 12th century. You also have contemporary communities that trace their origins to areas like Chad, Sudan, Senegal, Nigeria, that are coming into and building life and community in Palestine. You have the active creation of African community clubs as well too in this area of East Jerusalem. You have communities of African descent that you know, create syncretic forms of Christianity and Judaism that are termed as Hebronites, you know, that are living throughout occupied Palestine as well. You have also, you know, the existence, and I want to also to be clear that, you know, when we're talking about we're talking about the issue that is. The sort of current state of occupied Palestine and these Black and Palestinian solidarities, that we are talking specifically about Zionism. There is a distinction between, and I have to say this, there's a distinction between Zionism as a reactionary political and colonial and imperialist project, and then the spiritual systems of Judaism, right? That finds its continuities within African spiritual systems. And that's very important to bring up as well too. And especially when we, you know, the other night I was actually just reading this article from Charles Finch about Africa and Palestine in antiquity. So there is that very long and deep relationship that's there. But also thinking about the ways in which, you know, the experience of, you know, Ethiopian Jews in Israel proper as well, who experience, I mean, remember when, you know, these banners of Black Lives Matter and this organization of Black Lives Matter is, you know, is really catalyzing in around 2014, it happens in Israel as well amongst Ethiopian Jews who experience racism and police violence within the illegitimate state of Israel. And, you know, and they see their situation and their experience akin to what communities of African descent in America, and they actually say that, right? They experience, you know, discrimination. They experience being barred from jobs, being barred from higher levels of education in the community, right? They experience anti-Black racism. But going back to Afro-Palestinian communities as well too, and I think that, you know, the work that needs to be done more and more is really centering the roles of Afro-Palestinian communities. Because a lot of times, like, we don't see that these communities were also on the forefront of the Intifada. And people don't talk about that, right? We get, and this is not to eliminate or diminish the real active role that all Palestinians are playing in the Intifada, but we get images of people like Leila Khaled, but we don't get images of Afro-Palestinian men, women, and children that are on the forefront of Intifada that have been organizing.
The Palestinian youth movement. I have a comrade who's part of it, and you know, one conversation she was telling me, you know, Afro-Palestinians were, you know, major leaders in, you know, the PFLP, you know, Popular Front for Liberation, you know, Palestine, and you know, they were really, you know, playing a foundational role in these struggles. And I think, you know, as we talk about Black and Palestinian solidarities, when we can move in that position to, you know, African descended people in the U.S. really building relationships and you know, tight knit, you know, struggles and conversations with Afro-Palestinians, oh, we move on to a higher stage of struggle. And so I think in terms of, you know, future and continuity and, you know, assessments of what needs to be done, that's a gap in our work that we should address, you know, at the core.
And thank you, Ajamu, as we kind of round up or come to a conclusion, is that you mentioned specifically, you know, the future, or how do we look at substantive solidarity, building on the traditions and the ideas, and also the material fact that, you know, Black folk and people of African descent have always been in community and in struggle with Afro-Palestinians. And so as we kind of wrap up this conversation, you mentioned that point of what we can build on, but Dr. Siddiqui, you wanted to add to what we were talking about before, but also in your comments, make sure that you also touch on this question of how can we build real substantive solidarity? What are the futures, the potentialities at this particular moment and juncture in time?
Sure. So I wanted to also say, you know, and this is in giving in the context that we're experiencing right now, but also Afro-Palestinians not, you know, only experience the violence of Israeli apartheid, but also experience anti-Black racism within their own communities too. And these are some of the challenges and barriers that we see in terms of thinking about solidarity, right? Because solidarity really is a redefinition of our relationships to each other. And something that, you know, I was thinking a lot about as I was, you know, trying to organize my thoughts and really focus my comments for our conversation, I was thinking a lot about, you know, some of the work that Fred Moten has done in terms of thinking about the new insurgent feeling, thinking about the anti-national international, right? Because, you know, it's not about the sort of reinstantiation of the nation state, and that has to be really clear. It's about how we think about how we organize ourselves socially, what forms of political governance that we actually implement that is not a reproduction or a model of these racist, white supremacist, racial capitalist, you know, imperial and colonial states. That's not the goal, right? Two-state solution is not the goal. A Palestinian state that replicates those models is not the goal either. So when we're thinking about, you know, really what solidarity looks like, it's beyond the nation state as well. And I think a lot of it is too, is to think, and for me, when I think about solidarity, and I really try to think about what, you know, beyond struggle, but sometimes that becomes challenging, right? It becomes challenging to think about what we're struggling for and what we're trying to create. But I think that has to be something that is right in the, you know, sort of at the forefront of our mind. And it's about really refreshing this idea, as Fred Moten talks about, refreshing this idea of the alternative, what the alternative looks like. Because, you know, one of the things that is so part of sort of like the fundamental logic of the states or the nation states that we're dealing with is that they're against the social, they're asocial, right? And so, you know, for us to think about what is a new form of social relationships or a sociality, you know, look like. And for us as people of African descent, we're constantly gathering together, right? We're constantly in community. We're constantly like in congregation with one another. So what that looks like on an internet and sort of like a more broader international field and international scope, and really refusing, you know, this counter-revolutionary, counter-insurgent forces, refusing this idea of a two-state solution, you know, and so when we say that we're standing in solidarity, it's not just with Palestinians, with Afro-Colombians, right? With our brothers and sisters in Brazil, with our brothers and sisters in Venezuela, with our brothers and sisters in Cuba, with our brothers and sisters here in the Americas, First Nation and Indigenous communities, you know, what does that look like? And for me, I think a lot of that looks like is this active, radical engagement of a new world-making project. Is to create really those viable alternatives, those worlds. And a lot of it is coming through the protection and preservation of doing and really expanding and amplifying what we already do, and developing that, you know, not to constantly refer to it, but to the work of Dr. Pope in terms of thinking about, you know, developing really importantly. So this is where the intersection of knowledge and education comes in, you know, developing that critical Africana human rights consciousness. What does that actually look like? That's outside of and it's not this sort of radical break from this, you know, we're trying to make this radical break from this world to a world that, a utopia that doesn't exist. But it's about, and thinking about, you know, Brother Malcolm or Alhaj Malik al-Shabazz, this radical transformation of the society in which we live. And so for me, that's what solidarity looks like. And that we do that in whatever capacities or gifts and unique gifts that we are given, that we work really hard in cultivating those and amplifying those and constantly doing, like, that's the way that, because part of it is like for us as people of African descent and coming from an African worldview, part of our responsibility as a human being is to serve, is to be in relation, in good relation, in right relationship, right, with all forms of life. And that's, you know, that could be a challenge. You're tired, you're all this other different stuff, but I'm like, that constantly has to be something that is revived, right? That's part of the alternative, right? Reviving and redefining our relationships to one another, understanding what it actually means to be a human being, right? Which is a praxis, right? It's not something that just happens. And you can correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Pope, but it's like, when we look at our African deep thought, African spiritual systems, becoming human is a part of a praxis. It's part of a practice. So, you know, that's a long story short, that's sort of like what I'm understanding solidarity to look like and to mean.
I second everything that Dr. Siddiqui said, and want to emphasize the piece to serve. To serve, yeah, it can be tiring, it's draining. Sometimes you're like, yo, this is no joke. But, you know, it's a responsibility, you know, like Dr. Pope mentioned, it's a part of a tradition. You know, it's not something that we want to do or that we think we should do. It's something that we're obligated to do. And so, you know, as the atrocities go on in Palestine, the U.S. and Latin America, the Caribbean, on the continent of Africa, all over the world, let's, you know, those of us who are conscious and those of us who are, you know, on the path and, you know, enter into the conscious world, let's serve, let's fight. A new world, another world is possible. And it can only come through that serving and struggling, serve and struggle.
I'd like to thank both of you guys for having this very, very important, robust conversation. And I know our listeners, again, we wanted to throw so much against the wall that we wanted to give no excuse for people to not be in solidarity or to not have a clarity at this particular point with all of the information and all of the knowledge that has been produced around this particular instance coming, you know, again, exacerbating itself, you know, with the violence of last year and COVID and all these other particular things. I, again, you know, have argued consistently, we had a very important point, and there's a fracturing going on in European modernity that each of us, as Dr. Siddiqui says, bring your talents, bring your gifts, that I say that each of us need to grab a hold of that fracture and pull with all our might, as Ajamu was saying, is that, again, at the notion of what we're talking about, again, is the idea of how we build relationships with ourselves, but also simultaneously with others. And again, it's a struggle. You know, relationships are a struggle because, again, being human is a struggle. But being human in the context of the violence in which we're living in makes one extraordinary. Again, African people have always, you know, there was a saying, and I know most of our listeners know this particular saying, is that, you know, what the enslavement process did to ordinary people, and we're talking about ordinary people in the context of creating math, science, language, architecture, that's ordinary at one particular point. It made us extraordinary, right? But then we took that and made hip hop and made jazz and made art and made, you know, different ways. So this notion of that there's another world possible is that it's in front of us. You know, we have to look at this genealogy. And I wanted to point out to, you know, Cedric Robinson. Cedric Robinson wrote a very, very, as he's thinking about these relationships, he wrote a very important piece, A Pan-African Commonwealth, In Search for a Pan-African Commonwealth, where he lays out his thoughts on how do we build that substantive relationship. But then we can go back and look at Marcus Garvey. We can go back and look at the different types of formations, the Republic of New Africa, who are looking at land and understanding that relationship has to be a structural relationship built on different alternative logics than the nation state itself. And again, I wanted to, you know, as we close out, I wanted to give you both opportunity to leave us with some closing comments, if you have any. And yeah, I hope our listeners will join us, but I wanted to give you both time to give us some closing comments or a culminating summary of your thoughts or summary of some struggles or summary of whatever that you would love our listeners to think about at this particular moment. Again, moving this moment to be disruptive into disruptive moments tomorrow and 15 minutes from now, 16 minutes from now, whatever. So it will start with Ajamu and then we'll give space to Dr. Siddiqui.
Yeah, my comments are brief. If there's a, you know, action, you know, in your city, your neighborhood, today, I think, you know, try and go out there if it hadn't happened already. Here in Raleigh, ours starts at 2 p.m., but go out there, be a part of, you know, that energy and the developing of a new stage of struggle. Let's fight, you know, on all battle fronts. You know, let's not just hit the empire on one thing. Let's hit it on all angles to bring it down to his knees. Thanks for having me. Thanks for allowing me to learn, to contribute. And I'm looking forward to building with you two in the very near future. This conversation was very energetic. And so as I go out to the rally, this is what I needed. I'm gonna be hyped. I'm gonna be hyped. You know, it's time. So yeah, thank y'all, and let's continue to struggle and to serve.
And similarly, you know, thank you, Ajamu. It's just wonderful to be in conversation with you. Always wonderful to be in conversation with James. And in a similar way, you know, we're gonna here in DC, we're gonna march for Palestine. Thinking about the NEPCA 73, and it's unfortunate that we are celebrating 73 years of the NEPCA as well too. And I do want to leave, and you know, I'm going to keep my comments short, but you know, I saw Fred Moten give these comments at the American Studies Association meeting almost 10 years ago now on this new insurgent feeling. And at the time I understood it on a visceral level. Now, you know, almost a decade later, I understand it in a very different way. But, you know, I want to leave sort of with some of his comments, because for me, like, those were really beautiful. And it also thinks about, you know, what we mean when we're talking about solidarity. And he says, you know, Black insurgency, when we think about Black insurgency, it, you know, when we talk about Blackness, we have this conversation, it is all encompassing. We welcome everybody. But he says, you know, Black insurgency is rather an unruly, always beautiful, sometimes beautifully ugly, destabilizing and auto-destabilizing sociality as pathogen for the ones who desire precisely for that pathogen and its life-forming, life-giving properties is obsessive and murderous. And so I think for us, it's like we have to constantly think about how we're going to preserve and protect life on the earth. And we have to really reconnect with our knowledge systems, our spiritual systems, to give us the path forward, right? Our ancestors, we talk about this all the time, James, our ancestors created the map, and they're constantly speaking to us, and they're constantly, you know, showing us the way forward. You know, the divine is doing that as well. I'm a very spiritual person. The divine is constantly showing us this way forward. And I think that we have to listen. We have to stop and listen and start to think about, you know, how we walk differently on the earth, right? How we walk lightly on the earth. What does that look like for us in our own individual lives? And what does that look like collectively? Because, you know, we've been on this ride for a very long time. This is a point that needs to stop, that we need to get off and create something that is radically new and radically different. And we might not see that in our lifetime, but in those that are coming after us, that are here with us, we need to create something for them to actually like to live in and to exist and to thrive. So I say all that to say, organize, agitate, study, resist, and keep doubling down on your efforts. And I say that to myself first and foremost, and then to everybody else, take what you need, leave the rest. And whatever I said that is erroneous, that's my own fault, and everything else that is good for you. And that is from the divine, and that is from the ancestors. So thank you. Thank you for this conversation.
Ashe, and thank you for, again, sharing your time, both of you, sharing your time, sharing your thoughts, but also, again, providing an avenue of thinking that may be worn, but also may be new. So this is the platform, and this is what we intend to do, and this is what we're going to continue to do. We're going to continue to use these platforms, and Ajamu, of course, you will be roped in. As you probably got what we're doing at this particular point, like we're literally gradually bringing you into the fold here, you know, because again, you know, we're intentional. We're intentional about making sure that we are doing what we are called to do. Again, thank you guys both for sharing your time.
So, all you scared to death grow.